Listen you well to my word. One by land, two by sky. Look to the heptagon, for it is there. Seven times around go the three of you. And may your reward be just and true.
...1972's Encounter with the Unknown makes itself a powerful, powerful campaign for worst horror movie out of Arkansas. Really, worst any movie out of Arkansas, ever. With 600 poor souls rating it as such on IMDb. This movie is so bad, Charles B. Pierce of Boggy Creek fame almost went bald worrying people would think he had something to do with this movie. He didn't. If you can imagine what a Twilight Zone episode would look like if somebody just smacked the writer over the head with a bludgeon and then just forced everyone in the studio to drink before filming it, you can imagine a much better movie than Encounter. However, that is what I think this movie is trying to be. It's the 1970s Twilight Zone, except it's a movie and not a successful TV show that everyone likes. Anyway, pretty similar other than that, right? We'll find out. Starting with a bang, with a very eerie bird and rainbow logo, Encounter features three much less scary vignettes, stories that are connected about as well as three cats with their tails tied together. The intro text has a lot of words, more than Star Wars, so many words that the narrator just skips parts that he's not interested in, apparently. Refusing his lesson in time management, though, I paused the film and I read the text here. It's saying something about how all deadly weird stories in America can be connected to the people interred at a certain 23 cemeteries in America. I think. I can see why this was skipped. Apparently, for this movie, they picked the cheapest graveyard. Because the stories here, they all involve idiots. Well, next we're treated to an introduction. Wait. Yes. Another introduction.
There are few things as strange as reality. For reality comes to us wearing many faces, disguised as all manner of things.
Holy crap, Rod Serling! Yes, I am serious. That's why I mentioned the Twilight Zone before. That wasn't just unknown. There was a reason there. You see, this intro ties into our first story. After Rod gets done talking, we find out it centers on a woman who takes revenge on three college students who pulled a prank on her son, causing him to be castle doctrined to death by an old woman answering a doorbell late at night. This woman's curse is so weak, however, it literally tells you how to nullify it. If you avoid going into the open land or sky in the next 3 weeks after being cursed, you won't die. That's all you have to do to survive. Unfortunately for our cursed guys here, one is too busy bragging about beating their girls to remember to not walk in traffic. The next takes an airplane back from the first cursed friend's funeral. And the last one sucks up his grief and decides the only thing that can help him cope with the death of his two cursed friends is skydiving. Yes, skydiving. Just days after his two cursed friends died mysteriously from not heeding said curse's warning. This concludes the first story. Are you entertained yet? What's the point? Well, the only point you need to worry about is where I point to an exit from the theater. The next story is about a young boy who loses his dog. While looking for the dog, he uncovers an eerie hole. The hole is accompanied by strange groans, which isn't very surprising in a 70s movie, but it was fairly strange in the woods of early 1900s Arkansas. Thinking the dog must be somewhere down below, the boy's father volunteers to be lowered into the hole. While down there, he sees something in the hole, probably an advanced screening of this film that he's starring in. He screams, and he emerges, now completely insane. Was that entertaining? Okay, we'll keep going. Next is a tale of a ghostly girl. In her short life, she ran away with her boyfriend, a really good-looking dude who was really bad at watching the road. He manages to crash over the side of a bridge into the murky water below. Sploosh. Before you can say, Carnival of Souls, the girl is back topside, not drowned, and hitching a ride from strangers back home, a place she will never arrive at, disappearing from the car and presumably not paying her Uber fare either. Yep, it's Driving Miss Deadsy, and it's the best of the three stories here. Somewhat because it features decent cinematography and visuals, but mostly because it's near the end of the movie, and that's a wonderful feeling you really can't beat. Before Encounter is done, though, we get something really special that I have honestly not seen in a movie before. We get a recap of the entire film. A refresher before you're, I don't know, gonna get a test about what happened in the movie. It's like you're stuck in some sort of class, Bad Life Decisions 101 or something. And it's a test you are destined to fail because you watched this movie. You're never gonna pass Bad Life Decisions 101, dude. You watched Encounters with the Unknown. What's wrong with you, jerk? I'm sorry, you're not a jerk. It's the movie that's a jerk, but I have to say that or I have to watch the movie again because it's a really abusive relationship. You just don't worry about it. The word unknown is in the title because the reason for every single decision in this film is unknown. Why does the narrator not match what the intro text says? Why does the movie have two introductions with two different narrators? Especially when one of them's Rod Serling. Like, did they really think Mr. Serling wasn't good enough to carry the movie with this painfully obvious Twilight Zone callback, and they decided that it needed even more explanation that doesn't add anything, it just makes it more confusing? Were they trying to build a trilogy of terror here, maybe, and they just found Rod Serling's movie here and they shoehorned it into the film, just put it in the movie and hope people like it because he's in it? I don't know, but that's probably what happened. I don't think anyone's going to try and contradict me on that. If they do, wow, I have questions for you. So if you know more about this movie than me, if you were involved with this movie, please reach out because I want to just be like, how did you survive? Anyway, speaking of callbacks, the movie actually repeats itself in even more ways. I'm not kidding. It's not just the characters in each story retelling the movie's events. Oh, no. It's worse. The movie actually manages to achieve a flashback during a flashback during a retelling of the events by a character. I've honestly never seen a movie achieve such layers of repetitive, ridiculous, rotten onion magic. How? How was this? It's impressive. It's impressive. Wow, guys. Wow. Sometimes the film does a flashback not even 30 seconds after the reference scene just played. 30 seconds. I counted it. It's the scene with the woman uttering the curse from the first story, if you remember that. You've seen it enough times now, I think you do. I haven't even gotten done being angry at this woman's face, and they're playing the scene again! Just by seeing this scene, you can say you've seen 10% of Encounter with the Unknown's 90 minutes. It's repeated throughout the movie 7 times! 7! You had nothing. And you said, we gotta do 90 minutes of this, of nothing, nothing. You had nothing, what is wrong with you? I didn't even write this part of the script, guys. I'm actually just angry remembering what this film did to me. Like I said, it's just a very bad relationship, and I'm sorry to bring it up, but 7 times! 7! Imagine this, you're making a spooky ghost movie in the 1970s. I'm dancing here because that's already a recipe for a pretty good time. Pretty good fucking time here, yeah. Fucking ghost movie in the 70s. You can't fuck that up. That's great. Nah, man, it's not the cocaine. It's just how good this fucking idea is. You have 3 different stories with varying levels of plot and at least some things that you could convince a lie detector are neat ideas. So, shouldn't you be able to do something interesting at least once in 90 minutes? And Rod Serling is narrating? But instead of letting him be the focus, you allow some nobody to step on Mr. Serling's aural shoes with a tacked-on introduction? Many movies can be called awful. But how many of those movies had this many chances to be good? It's easy to be bad, but it's hard as hell to be this bad. Wow! I give Encounters with the Unknown 1. A generous, stupid, overcompensated 1 sincere incantation that I will adhere to and hope that this movie never, ever crosses my path again. I still want to hear from you if you were involved in this movie because it just sounds like it would be a freaking hilarious story. or one that's actually scarier than this entire movie. Just like a ghost looking for an Uber, I'm still around. I'm out here, guys. I'll always be around. And so will these damn movies! Ugh!